Look at your neighbor and say, man, you look good. Look at your other neighbor and say, woo, you look even better. Come on, guys, I need you to help me tonight. I don't know about you, but I'm ready to blow the roof off this place. Are you guys ready? Come on. Help me put your hands together. Ready? And if your neighbor ain't doing it, say, man, what's your deal? Hey, let me show you. It's like this. Giving it all away. glory and all the honor. Does anybody love Jesus in this place here tonight? Anybody thankful for his amazing grace in your life? His amazing, amazing grace and his mercy in your life. If that's you in this place, shout hallelujah.
Especially if you have some first-time visitors, I don't want to mislead anybody, misguide anybody. I don't want anybody leaving this church saying, man, you know what, it wasn't what I thought it was going to be. So I'm going to clarify all that right now, okay? Okay, so if you're here looking for some bad news, look at your neighbor and say, we don't have it. If you're looking for some good news here tonight, here it is. Here it is. If you're looking for some good news, here's the good news. On the third day, Jesus Christ rose from the grave. I said Jesus rose from the grave. And no matter where you're at, no matter what you're going through, there is an answer, not to some things, but to all things that you might, whatever the situation might be. It's not bigger than God. It's not greater than God. There is a solution, and his name is Jesus. Amen? So find five people and say, it's just good news in this place. Amen, amen. And you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. No bad news, no bad news. No bad news. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you're glad to be here, say good amen. Amen. And how many people realize it's okay to have fun in church, okay? There's a time and a place for it. For everything, you know, when we start off a service and we're just, you know, in worship and praise right now, it's okay to have fun. There's a time and a place. Now, if we're like, you know, jumping up and down when the preaching of the word was going forth, then security would have been all over you. Amen? See, God is a God of order, but at the same time, he wants us to have fun. Church should be exciting. It should be a place that you look forward to going to. Amen? And so praise the Lord. Well, it's good to have everybody here. If you are here for the first time, we do have something for you in the bookstore on the way out as a way of saying thank you for coming and trusting us with the things of God. And if, if you're looking for a church home, if there's a card there to fill out, and we will love to answer any questions and help you with that. And we'd love to have you here. Amen. Praise the Lord. Or any other questions you might have or prayer requests, there's a card you can fill out on the way out in the bookstore. Praise God. Couple quick announcements, and we're going to move quickly forward in the service. Also, tomorrow, we also have a Sunday morning service at 10:30, and but between 9 and 10, we have a breakfast ministry that's outside in the patio areas, and it's free breakfast. We have it every Sunday morning. If you haven't made it to one of those, I would encourage you to come, bring a friend, and enjoy breakfast before coming to service. Amen. And breakfast is off the hook here in the morning. Amen. It is. We're not talking just a piece of cracker and some water. Amen. I'm serious. We eat pancakes sometimes. I mean, it's just, you know, it just depends what they come up, you know. So, I mean, it's like coffee. And, you know, some might say, what's the catch? There is no catch. That's how we roll here. Amen. Look at someone and say, that's just how they roll here. Amen. So come and enjoy breakfast in the morning between 9 and 10, and then service starts at 10:30 tomorrow morning. Praise God. Cheryl, quick announcement. Give Pastor Cheryl a hand.
Praise God. Well, after tonight's, I don't know if we call it a service, illustrated sermon, and a lot of fun coming up here, I know you're going to be really hungry, right? So the women's ministry is having a fundraiser, and we're selling nachos. And with jalapenos, if you want those, along with a bottle of water for $4. So all you need to do is go out the front door, walk around to the back of the church, and we'll be selling the tickets right as you come into the kitchen. And we've got plenty of servers, so we're going to try and serve you really fast. So please make yourselves available to that.
Guys, so please, yes, and you know that helps take care of that. And you know, even this last year when they did that, there's other you know, some people aren't able to make that trip or afford that trip, and because of others, you know, that's how we made it possible for everybody to be part of it. So, and again, everything we do here, we always want to make sure everybody that wants to go, it goes. Amen. So that's right after service, okay? Praise God. Let me have the ushers quickly come forward at this time, and we'll take the offering. All right. You know, when we give, we take on the nature of God, for the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he did what? He gave his only begotten son. Amen. So praise God. So what a privilege it is to be able to give into the kingdom to reach the world for Jesus. Amen. Should be an excitement. So are you ready to give? Yeah. No, you're not. Are you ready to give? Yeah. Amen. If you need an offering envelope, just raise your hand. There should be one in the seat pocket in front of you. If not, if you raise your hand, we'll get one out to you as quickly as possible. And watching online, and everybody, want to say thank you for your faithfulness and your support and your commitment to help us make this ministry, this miracle, a reality for the glory of God. Amen. And for many that are coming here for the first time also, this helps a lot of different ministries here, prison ministry, bus ministry that runs three services every week, television ministry, and I can go down the list, praise God. And so this is what you're sowing into. You're sowing into souls, amen? And praise God. Pastor Paul, why don't you come up here? Our dear friend Pastor Paul's in the house also. We'll go. Why don't you pray first? All right. Just pray first and then stay right here for a second.
All right.
I got a problem.
That's why. Go ahead. Go ahead. Let's bow our heads. Father God, we thank you for this night, this moment. We just thank you for your grace and your mercy. Lord, I pray that we just give out of the abundance of our heart and we have a joyful heart. We just thank you, Lord, for what you are about to do. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Praise God. You guys go ahead and serve the people at this time. Go ahead and serve the people. Pastor Paul, okay. Dear friend of mine here at Pastor's Church, just a little, about 5 minutes from here, amen, 10 minutes, 10 minutes away. But I got a problem with this jersey, amen. This is like really, like seriously right now, it's like, you know, I'm having a problem with this because, you know, I know God brought us together to work together, to be friends, and to also work together for the kingdom of God. But this is starting, this separates, this starts, you see? So can you, I mean.
Appreciate how much I love my brother.
Oh, come on. Look, you know what? Wow. That's why he's my friend. Amen. Now watch this. Did the people in our church that I have been so patient with every time we have these type of events and these type of services, especially during the Super Bowl, what do we say? Dallas Cowboys stuff is not allowed. And you guys continually come in with your Dallas stuff. But I want you guys to follow. Did you catch that here today? The man of God's example here. I said the man of God's example. And you see how he got rid of that Dallas Cowboys jersey? Amen. And because of that, praise the Lord. You can put it back on, and we can stay friends. Amen.
I thought I was told tonight was Dallas Cowboy night for prayer. I don't know. I just...
Lord, what are you doing here? Amen. Praise God. It's a test. It's a test. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Well, you guys, God bless you. And again, thank you for coming, especially people that have never been to this church before. We thank God for you. Thank you for trusting us with the things of God. And I believe you made a wise decision by being here. You're in for a special blessing. And God bless every one of you. Amen. Are you guys ready for tonight? Yeah. Amen. Praise God. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to Fire and Water International Church. How many came here who love Jesus? How many came here tonight hungry for something from God tonight? How many came here expecting great things from the Lord tonight? How many of you want to get this party started for God?
Y'all ready for this?
stand and shout. Let's get ridiculous for Jesus. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How many sports fans do we have here tonight? How many basketball fans do we have here tonight? All right, let me ask a question. Do we have any Laker fans in here? All right, do we have any other Bulls fans like Pastor Gus here? How about Dallas Mavericks fans? Do we have any Dallas fans here? We don't have any San Antonio Spurs fans in here, do we? I'm wondering, how many Phoenix Suns fans do we have in the house tonight? Yeah, hallelujah. Ladies and gentlemen, we want to thank you for coming tonight to speaking to the place to be tonight, Saturday night in Phoenix. Fire and Water International Church, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. And now, we would like to introduce you to Fire and Water's own dance team. Let's hear it for them. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, please stand and remove your hats for the singing of the national anthem. And now, to honor America, please welcome Fire and Water's very own Academy Award winner and four-time Grammy nominee, Josie Brandon.
And the rocket say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free?
The Spurs and Heat are back in Miami. They've alternated wins for five straight games, providing us with a series of extreme twists and turns. LeBron James and the Heat facing elimination. Can he lift it? A blowout in game two. Bosh connect. Until the last game, the Spurs came out big. It's Duncan, Ray Allen, Danny Green, Gary Neal. Incredible three-point shooting. Miller off the dribble. Bosh off the miss.
Smart play, not to stop the ball and leave Green open.
Oh, Wade with a beautiful size. Leonard, short, Duncan right there to clean it up. Duncan is just playing off of enough to kind of dare him to shoot. James kicks it out. Chalmers from the corner, that's good. Mario Chalmers. Parker on the penetration. Contact, count it, and one. Parker gets inside. Wild shot, won't go. Box the rebound. And the third quarter comes to an end. Clutch one there from Leonard. Should the Spurs foul? Should Miami go for the three right away?
Just attack the basket.
James catches, puts up a three. Won't go. Rebound Bosh. Back out to Allen. His three-pointer. Bang! Tie game with 5 seconds remaining. Spurs do not have a timeout. But the officials are going to review to see if Allen was behind the line. Three. Green trying to get free. Cross court pass to Green. Green blocked by Bosh. Game over. There'll be a game seven. Door gets away from Miller, and a nice finish for the San Antonio Spurs. Wade trying to take advantage of Neal, and he does.
But Mike, this to me has the feel of a Lakers-Celtics game seven, where the offense just wasn't there, and it was just a grind-out game.
Daddy, 3 for 3 from downtown.
There's some guys like Dwayne Wade who looks energetic.
James and a foul. 2/10 of a second remaining. Green fires. And the first half of game seven comes to an end. Off the screen. James will try another three. Puts it in. LeBron James. Chalmers racing up the floor. Sets, fires, three-pointer. Oh, he banks it in. At the buzzer. Pulls up. Puts it in. 4-point lead. Chalmers. Wade throws it up to James. The Spurs will not foul. Final seconds. What a finish. It's back-to-back titles for the Heat. The 2013 NBA championship resides once again in Miami.
Want to start off by giving you the definition of rebound. To increase or improve after a recent decrease or decline. Rebound. To increase or improve after a recent decrease or decline. When Miami beat San Antonio a few years ago back, it would have never taken place. There would have never been a game seven. You know, the NBA championship, it's a best of seven series, so the first team that wins 4 games wins the championship. There would have never been a game seven if somebody from Miami did not go up for a rebound. Let me put it this way. Somebody from Miami was still willing to not give up after a missed shot. And because there was a willingness to go after the rebound, Allen hit the three-pointer to tie the game, but there would have never been an opportunity for him to shoot that three-pointer if somebody on that team was not willing to go up for the rebound after it was missed. And because there was somebody that was willing, there was a shot, he did make it, and there was a game seven. Because Miami went on to win game six in overtime, but let me say it like this, there would have never been an overtime if there wasn't a rebound, and there would have never been a three-point shot made by Allen, because that would have never happened if there wasn't a rebound, which means then there wouldn't have been an overtime, and if there wasn't an overtime, Miami wouldn't have won the game, so there wouldn't have been a game seven. Now, so because, do you see the domino effect here? There was a rebound after a miss. There was a three-pointer made. There was an overtime that Miami went ahead and beat San Antonio. So that means there was a game seven. And because it was a game seven, Miami had an opportunity to win a game seven, which led them to winning a championship. But there wouldn't have been a game seven. There would have never been a three-pointer. There would have never been an overtime. They would have never been in that position if somebody didn't go up for the rebound. And because there was a willingness, Miami went ahead and won their second championship in a row. Back to back. But we're talking basketball right now, but I want to actually talk about another game. Not basketball, but actually the game of life. I want to, another game. And I want to talk about some people actually that because they were willing to rebound, they were willing not to give in and give up after they missed a shot. Some missed many shots in the game of life. But because they were willing to stay in the game, they were willing to go to the boards and still go up for the rebound, they had another opportunity to make a shot, to put themselves in position to be champions, to be strong finishers, the game of life. I want to talk about a few people in the Bible that we have a tendency when we hear about them that they, I can never be like them. I can never measure up to them because, you know, these are people that are in the Bible. This is God's hand was on them, and these are evangelists and great prophets and disciples, and I can never be like them. But in reality, they were just like us. So I want you to understand this. The Bible said even the prophet Elijah in the book of James was a man just like us that was available that God used. That was available that God used. Again, rebound, to increase or improve after a recent decrease or decline. We think of Moses. I mean, how can I ever be like Moses? Well, when you really think about Moses, that God raised up to lead the people of Israel out of some 400 years of bondage, and the great Moses that led the people across the Red Sea, where the Red Sea opened up and they crossed over. And the great Moses, prior to that, went to Pharaoh and said, "Let my people go." 10 plagues later, I mean, God using him in such great and powerful ways. But if we rewind the tape, Moses missed a few shots before he made a few. I said he missed a few shots. When we rewind the tape some 40 years prior to showing up and coming back to Egypt, where God raised him up to be the senior pastor of the greatest and largest church of its time, I want you to catch this. The largest church in the world, God chose Moses to be the senior pastor. Now, Moses, wait a minute, but 40 years prior, it was Moses that actually murdered, took a life. So let me say like this. Moses took a life and then wandered and fled Egypt and wandered and was away for some 40 years. In other words, he was an ex-con. He had a history. He had messed up. He took a life. He ran. He was full of fear. I can go down the list. And wait a second. But God, after all that, chooses Moses to be the senior pastor of the largest church of its time in the world to deliver his people out of Egypt? Moses that missed shot after shot, that had messed up, that did not make his first couple shots. But then, after he surrendered to God Almighty, when he surrendered and was willing to submit to the opportunity, the privilege, and the honor to serve for his kingdom, when he surrendered to God and to God's plan and to God's purpose, God turned his life around, raised him up, and used him for his glory. In other words, he missed some shots. There was some decrease and there was some decline there in the beginning and in the middle there. But his last 40 years, his first 80 were, but the last 40, at the age of 80, there was increase and there was improvement. But because he didn't quit in the game, Miami, even though it looked hopeless there at the end, because game 6, San Antonio should have won, many would say. But because Miami was willing to still stay on the court and fight and not give up and kept going after their misses and grabbing the rebounds, they won a championship. Moses might have not started strong, but he finished as a champion. I said he finished as a champion because he was willing to rebound. Look at somebody. It's not the way you start. It's the way you finish. It's not the way you start. It's the way you finish. But how about Jacob in the Bible? I mean, you think about some of these people in the Bible, but when you start to really examine their lives, they missed a lot of shots. Their percentage wasn't very high. I'm going to say it like this. Their percentage was not very high. They missed many shots. But the reason why they finished and were great champions is because they refused to give in and give up and surrendered and submitted when the opportunity was there to God, when God's mercy was there, when God's grace was there. They surrendered and they finished strong for his glory. Jacob, the Bible tells us, was a his name means deceiver. His name meant deceiver. So in other words, Jacob, I mean, he missed not a few times, but over and oh, well, praise God. Sometimes you just can't help it when you got the, you know, when it's in you, amen. Try to miss and you still make it, amen. Amen. If it wasn't for the knees. But Jacob, he missed over and over and over. He was a deceiver. He was a trickster. Let me bring it to inner city Phoenix. He was a hustler, amen. He was a hustler. He tricked his father and took his brother's blessing. He deceived his own father. We're talking about great man of God and deceiving his father, and that was his life. That was the way he lived, and that's. But then, one day, when he heard about his brother coming, that he tricked and deceived also and took his blessing from, he was in fear of his life because he's like, I wonder if my brother, how he's going to respond after all this time. He was afraid of his life. And the Bible says he had an encounter with God and he wrestled all night long. What I'm trying to say is that means that he missed, but he didn't quit, and he kept on going to the boards. He kept on going to the boards and kept on shooting. And the Bible says after the wrestling match that Jacob, after he had that opportunity to be in that arena, amen, with the Lord, praise the Lord, the Bible says that Jacob got touched, and he had a name change. It's symbolic that his life changed. He wasn't a trickster anymore, because he went from Jacob, his name was changed to Israel, amen. He went from being a trickster to a prince for the glory of God. And the Bible says when he walked out, that he walked out with a limp after that wrestling match, after that time being with the Lord all night long. And he came out with a limp, which is symbolic that he went in one way and he came out another. His walk had changed. He wasn't a trickster anymore. He wasn't a hustler anymore. He wasn't a deceiver anymore. But now his walk changed. What does that mean? He wasn't who he was before. God touched his heart now. Amen. So now he started to walk like God, talk like God, do like God. Amen. And because he was willing to go up for the rebound. But you can't go up for the rebound if you don't stay in the game. You can't have the opportunity for a rebound if you quit, if you give up. How about, let's go to the New Testament. How about Peter? Woo. Peter, the disciple Peter? Well, he was a great man. Peter. Peter that walked with Jesus. Saw the miracles, saw blind eyes opened up, deaf ears opened up, the lame walking. He saw the multitudes. Peter was with Jesus. The Bible says, Emmanuel, God with us. Jesus, God himself in human form. Think about this. Jesus stepped out of eternity, stepped into time, because he loved you and me so much. And during that time, Peter, who was the creation, he walked with the Creator. Wait a second. Peter, the creation, was walking with the Creator, the one that made him. The invention was walking with the inventor. The clay was walking with the potter. The one, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, Jesus, Peter walked with him, was part of his ministry. Peter was there when Lazarus was dead for 4 days, and Jesus shows up on the scene, and said, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus, that was dead for 4 days, came back to life. Peter was there. Now, you would think that somebody that was walking with Jesus and saw all those miracles would never turn back, would never leave the church, would never backslide. It's no way. How could you back? There's no way you'd leave. You'd never turn from the Word of God. But when Jesus was about to be taken to the cross, Peter, the Bible says, the same Peter denied Christ 3 times. Miss, miss, miss. Think about denying Christ. I'm not talking about getting drunk for a night. I'm not talking about lying, but all sin is sin anyway. Sometimes we try to, it's still sin, amen? It doesn't, we have a tendency to kind of like, you know, well, I'm not as bad as that person is. It's still sin. Well, I don't do drugs like they do. No, but you got pride and you're arrogant. And actually, you might not do drugs, but your drug is pride and arrogance. And you think you're all that in a bag of chips, and you're not all that in a bag of chips. The only way you're all that in a bag of chips, let me help somebody, is when you got Jesus and you're surrendered to Him. So watch this. But I'm just saying, Peter denies God. You would think it's over. Game over. You would think, shut off the lights, empty the arena, everybody go home. This thing is over. The Bible lets us know that after Peter's recent decrease and decline, he put himself in position, because the Bible says that he wept. He cried out. He understood what he did was wrong, and the conviction led him to a place of weeping. And those tears are symbolic of repentance and getting it right with God. And so he went from decrease and decline, missing and messing up, to increase and improving, because by doing so, he positioned himself to allow the grace, the mercy, and the love of God to pick him back up and to give him another opportunity, because he didn't give up after he missed once and twice and 3 times. But he went up when he wept, when he repented, when he surrendered, when he submitted, he had another opportunity for improvement. He had an opportunity to finish as a champion. He had an opportunity to not let his past dictate his future. And watch me now. And because he was willing to rebound, the grace, the mercy, the love of God showed up. And this isn't a year later. This isn't 5 months later. Some 50 days later or so. Bible says that on the day of Pentecost, Jesus had departed, and the Holy Spirit had been released, had come down, and the upper room, and they were all filled, the Bible said, and the Lord, let me say it like this, it was a conference taking place in Jerusalem, and there was about 120 gathered, and you would think, out of all the speakers, Peter would be on the bottom of the list. He just messed up not too long ago. He had just denied Christ three times. So you for sure, if I had a list, he'd be 120, right? Wouldn't he be 120? Well, that's how we are in church today. When somebody messes up, we're so quick to judge. We're so quick to tear down. And I'm not talking about people that are playing games. I'm not talking about people that are sheep in wolf's clothing. Or wolves in sheep's clothing. Yeah, flip it. Amen. Amen. I knew what I was doing. I was just making sure you're paying attention. Amen. And I'm talking about people that they know they've messed up. They do love the Lord. They're trying to get it right. And we're so quick to criticize. We're so quick to get on email. We're so quick to get on Facebook and tell everybody what you heard or what you saw. Because you do know I've got to insert this, even though I'm trying to get us somewhere, but it is important for me to insert this, amen? The greatest enemy against the church in the work of the Lord, it's not outside the church, it's from within. Because the church, the people that say they are born again, the people that are saved, if we could just come together, but the enemy comes in to divide because he knows a house divided can't stand. Where there's unity, there's power. The Bible says where there's unity, there's a commanded blessing. But we're so quick to tear down. We're so quick to criticize. We're so quick to get on the phone and gossip instead of being quick to cover, quick to protect, quick to pick up, quick to encourage, quick to pray instead of gossiping, getting on our knees and praying for one another and interceding for one another. My God, how many tragedies could be avoided? How many more champions would the church have today? What am I saying? Because most of us, or most, let's say, even leadership would never have put Peter where Jesus put Peter. Watch this. It would have been 120, but so many days later, there's a conference, Jerusalem, and out of all the people that get to speak, God raises up Peter to be the keynote speaker in the church of Jerusalem. I mean, in Jerusalem, and he preaches a 10-minute message. This is the guy that denied Christ three times. This is the guy that missed over and over and over. But he was willing to rebound. Preaches a 10-minute message, the cross. Preaches a 10-minute message, and some of the people that were in the crowd were some of the people he was afraid of and denied Christ in front of. That's right. And now he's preaching his little heart out. Now he's preaching the cross. He's preaching about Jesus, that he's the only way. And 3,000 people get saved on that day. But God is so good when we are willing to rebound and not quit and have faith. Watch this. In the game of life, because we will have our moments that we don't serve a God of just enough. When we are willing to get back up and go get the rebound and shoot again and get it right and keep on shooting until we make it, we serve the God of more than enough. More than enough. I'm sorry. Not just enough, but more than enough. He exceeds our expectations. So he preaches, 3,000 people get saved, and then God says, no, you're not done yet. You're going to write 1 Peter and 2 Peter. I'm going to use you as the vessel, and you're going to be through my spirit, and you're going to write two books of the Bible that people are going to be reading some 2,000 years later so they can come to the cross. Yeah, there you go. Why? Peter, that denied Christ three times, but he didn't quit. He stayed in. He kept on shooting, and because he kept on shooting and kept on being willing to go get the rebound, he finished as a champion. Let me give you one more real quick. How about the Apostle Paul? Woo! How about the Apostle Paul, the great Apostle Paul, that God has used to write two-thirds of the New Testament has been written through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, which is God, but the vessel that God used is Paul, two-thirds of it. Wait, but before he was Paul, he was Saul? He was the one that was trying to stamp out Christianity? He was trying to kill Christians and take out the he was against the cross. He was there when Stephen was being stoned, and Stephen looked up, full of the Spirit of God, preaching his little heart out, loving on the people, and they're about to kill him. And he looks up and he saw Jesus standing right hand of the Father. And he said to Jesus, he looked up, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." Here's somebody saying to the ones that are about to kill him and take their life, "Forgive them." At that point, you would think some would just drop the sword. You would think, let's just let them go, you know. This message that this person's preaching is a message of hope and love. And Paul, back then known as Saul, was on the sidelines giving the approval of the stoning of Paul. I mean, of Stephen, I'm sorry. So Stephen, his life comes to an end, and Paul was connected to that. Talking about missing in the game of life, talking about messing up, I'm not talking about, you're talking about somebody that was coming against God himself. The magnitude of the sin. I mean, he wasn't even coming close to the rim. But you know what? The Bible says on the way to Damascus, because he was on a mission, he had an encounter with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The opportunity was being presented to him, and he was touched by God. He was touched by Jesus, and the Bible says that from that point on, that his heart was changed, and he was convicted, and he understood that he was fighting against God himself. And when he got up after that encounter with God, the Bible says he never looked back again. That Paul went on. He went from being Saul, he had a name change to Paul, which means little one. He became humble because Saul was a prestigious name, a very prideful name, amen? So he went from that to Paul. In other words, that's the transformation, the name change, that his life was changed, amen? And the Bible lets us know that Paul finished strong in his faith, that God used him to impact cities and countries for the glory of God. What you realize, one touch from Jesus and you'll never be the same again. But he was willing when the opportunity was given to him to surrender and to follow Christ, to let go of his plan and his will and his way, and he received God's way and God's plan and God's will for his life. In other words, he got the rebound and he put it back up, and because of it, Paul finished strong for the glory of God. Amen. You got it. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. But you can't finish strong unless you stay in the game and keep on fighting the good fight of faith, getting back up, amen, and not allowing the enemy to keep rewinding your past, saying, "This is who you are. God doesn't love you. You'll never be forgiven." Let me tell you something. The devil is a liar. As long as you're willing to go for the rebound, there's a God in heaven that still forgives. There's a God in heaven that still is full of grace and full of mercy. I said there is a God in heaven that still delivers. There's still a God in heaven that sets people free. There's still a God in heaven that restores families. There's still a God in heaven that heals, restores, and still saves for his glory. Amen. Actually, right now, we're talking about Paul and how he didn't start strong, but he stayed in the game. And he rebounded, and he finished strong for the glory of God. He finished as a champion for Christ. But I just want to go to one of the places to see Paul in action after his conversion, after his rebound. I want to go to a place, actually a prison, where Paul and Silas were after they were apprehended for preaching the gospel. Watch this.
Driven to unconsciousness by the stripes upon his back, he heard a voice call out his name. His mind began to clear. In the darkness he replied, "Silas, I am here." Oh, my brother Silas, Paul uttered with a groan, "Today I thought for sure we were going home. And when I opened up my eyes, I'd look upon his face. Here we are together in this dreadful place. But I will praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord. No matter what tomorrow brings, or what it has in store, I know I will praise." What it has in store, I know I will praise the Lord. This may be a prison, these may be chains, still I am free, free to praise his name. Up, singing filled their ears. Some men started swearing, others were in tears. Suddenly it happened, there was no mistake.
What it has in store, I know I will praise.
the great Apostle Paul, the great Apostle Paul was stamping out, was trying to stamp out Christianity. And then we see him in a prison ready to lay down his life for Christ. I mean, there was another time where he was stoned and he was thrown out of the city and left for dead. Literally, he was like a breath. I mean, he was left for dead, the Bible says. And then the church came and prayed for him. And I mean, think about this. Talking about rebounding. First, you're trying to take out the church. Now you're ready to lay down your life for the church. Can someone say he rebounded? I want you to hear this tonight because God is speaking to some people in this room that think it's over, that think that God doesn't love you anymore. There's people in this room that think it's too late. There's people in this room that think you've missed too many times. But I'm here to tell you, you're still in the game. How do I know that? Because you're still breathing. You're still alive, which means there's still an opportunity for you to get the rebound and shoot again. God's grace is here. God's mercy is here tonight. God's love is here tonight. The Lord's put all this together just for you tonight to let you know. It's not an accident that you're here tonight. And let me say this also. There's not one accident in this room. There's not one mistake in this room. No one in this room has been called just to take up space and just to be. God has called every one of us in this room to be great champions for his glory. The Bible says that he's not a respecter of persons. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Which means if Moses can rebound through the grace of God, if Jacob can rebound with the help of the Lord, if Paul can rebound because of the grace of God, if Peter, after denying Christ three times, could come back and finish strong through Christ, that means if he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he's not a respecter of persons, that means I qualify to be part of that list after missing some shots in the game of life. But if I'm willing to not give up, to keep shooting, keep getting back up. If God was patient with Moses, if God was faithful with Jacob when he wasn't faithful, God remained faithful to him. If God was patient with Peter after Peter knew him. Now I'm talking to some church folk that have been away from church. I'm not talking people don't know Jesus now. God's trying to help somebody in this room. That's how much he loves you. If God was patient with Peter, that, let me put it like this, that left the church, that rebelled against God after being with him, after serving in the ministry, and was faithful when Peter was not faithful, is God not going to do the same for you and me? The only way tonight that we miss the love, the grace, the mercy of God here tonight, the forgiveness of God here tonight, is if you choose to put down the ball and walk away. But if you choose to stay in the game and go after the rebound, I'm here to tell you, God is saying to you tonight, you're going to get the rebound and you're going to put it back in. Well, how can you be so sure that I'm going to get this rebound, I'm going to shoot, and I'm going to make it tonight? Because with the help of God, and guess what? God has never lost the game. I said he's perfect. He's undefeated. I said God is perfect. Jesus is undefeated. And the Bible says I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. So when I surrender to his will, to his way, and to his purpose, and I open up my heart and run to him, I'm here to tell you, you're not just going to make the shot. You're going to dunk the ball. Get my basketball hoop back out of here. Just right there in the corner. Just put it in the corner here. I got to do this. Tonight, right there. That's perfect. Thank you, Steve. Right there. Tonight, as long as you stay, God loves and God's mercy and God's grace. And if he did it for all these in the past, how about I've been talking about Rahab the prostitute. I'm trying to get us somewhere so we can finish. Rahab the prostitute. I mean, the Bible talks about that she helped the spies come in. That were trying to. They were sent by Joshua into Jericho to spy on the land. And when word came out that they were looking for them, Rahab the prostitute was the one that hid them. So she had an opportunity to protect God's plan, God's purpose, God's will. Because when he protected those two spies, that was and she received them in her home. That was symbolic of her receiving God in her life and surrendering to God's will and God's way. And the Bible goes on to say, later on, because of what she did, she started off as a prostitute, but she didn't finish as a prostitute. She didn't allow her past to define her future. She finished as a champion. She missed many shots. But then the Bible talks about how God raised her up and the great-grandmother of David and in the lineage of Christ. And did you hear that? That messes with people. And also made Hebrews chapter 11 the hall of faith. Rahab? Why? Because when the opportunity presented it to herself, she didn't quit. She went up for the rebound and she put it back up and she finished as a mighty woman of God. Now I'm telling you here tonight, as long as you don't quit and you're willing to get up here tonight, amen, and you're willing, watch this, to surrender to God's will, God's purpose, God's way for your life. Because the Bible says, unless he builds the house, you labor in vain to build it. In other words, if Christ ain't the foundation, it will come down, amen. But when Christ is the foundation, you might go through some stuff, but when it's all said and done, you will finish strong. You will be victorious. You will come out stronger. You will come out higher. Amen. You will finish strong. And when it's all said and done, you'll hear these words, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." Hallelujah. And tonight, I'm here to tell you, if you're willing to go up for the rebound, you're not just putting up a shot from far away or shooting from a distance. Tonight, it's a guaranteed dunk. Amen. For his glory. Somebody shout yes. So Paul ends up, he gets stoned and he's in this outside the city and then he gets back up. And how many of us would get back up after you're this close to death and go back to the same city to the same people they tried to take your life? Read your Bible. You know what? He went back. How do you do that? He was trying to take out Christianity because he rebounded and Christ invaded his life and his life was never the same. In other words, he lost his mind and he gained the mind of Christ. And when you lose your mind and you gain his mind, when you lose your heart and you gain his heart, you start doing some stuff you'd never do. You start saying stuff you'd never say. You start doing stuff and willing to do stuff that is not self-centered, but it's Christ-centered. But I'm here to tell you tonight, every one of you in this room, no matter where you're at, God's mercy is here, God's grace is here, and you have an opportunity tonight, and God is speaking to many tonight that have missed many shots, and you're ready to give up, you're ready to give in, but God is saying, if you're willing to go up for that rebound and not quit, there's still hope. There's still an answer. There's still grace. There's still mercy. There's still forgiveness available for you. And I don't care how much you've done and how great the sin might be. If you're here tonight, God is not intimidated with your sins, but he died for every one of your sins. If you're struggling here tonight, let me talk to somebody here tonight with an addiction or a cycle that just seems to never end in your life. And I know I'm speaking to many here, and I need everybody, unless it's an emergency, to please sit down during this time right now. This is very important. This is a holy moment, unless it's an emergency. Everyone sitting, be still, please. Cycles where you think you got the victory, and then you're going forward, and there you are again doing the same thing. And it's been some years, and you think, and you're at that place where you're like, I'm tired, this is hopeless. I've tried. Sometimes you got to go up for that rebound, and you'll miss again, and you'll miss again. But if you keep on being willing to rebound, I'm here to tell you there is breakthrough, there is victory, and there is an answer. The Bible says in Galatians 6:9, don't grow weary in doing good, for in due season you're going to reap a harvest. Here's a saying for you. Effort only fully releases its reward when somebody refuses to give up. Look at somebody and say, don't you dare give up. The Bible says a righteous man falls 7 times, but he gets back up. I'm going to say that again. A righteous man falls 7 times, but he gets back up. Amen. A righteous man falls 7 times, but he gets back up. Find 5 people, say, get back up, get back up, get back up. Hallelujah. Get back up. The next rebound is yours. The next rebound is yours. The next rebound is yours. Get back up in the name of Jesus. Amen. It's not the way you start, it's the way you finish. And no matter what you're going through or how great it seems to be or how big the mountain might seem, there is an answer, and there is hope here tonight, and his name is Jesus. Amen. I want you to watch this last drama, and we're going to finish with a prayer here tonight.
Dark ones came, stole my mind, wrapped my soul in chains. Now I live among the dead, fighting voices in my head, hoping someone hears me crying in the night.
Bible says, turn to me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you, and you will honor me. Turn to me, Psalms 50:15 says, turn to me in the day of trouble. It doesn't say turn to me in the day of trouble, and I might, or I'll think about it, or I'll get back to you, but I will. In other words, if you've missed some shots in the game of life, you've messed up. For some, you've been in church and you've messed up. You've left. You've rebelled. You've been like Peter for a moment there. For others, this is the first time you're hearing this message, or you've never given your heart to Jesus. I want to say this to you tonight, that God is crazy about you, that God loves you. There's not 10 ways to heaven. There's not 20 ways into heaven. There's only one way to heaven. There's only one that forgives our sins. One that died on the cross, and it's through his blood and the sacrifice of Jesus Christ that took your place and my place for our sins, that gives us entrance to heaven. One way to heaven. One that died on the cross and rose from the grave on the third day. The Bible says there's one mediator between heaven and earth. His name is Jesus Christ. We're about to celebrate Easter here pretty soon. What's that all about? Resurrection Sunday. Amen. That on the third day, Jesus rose from the grave. If if there's just a crucifixion and there's no resurrection, there'd be a problem. Because many people have been crucified. But he rose. There was a cross and there was a resurrection. And that same resurrection power that raised Jesus from the grave is the same resurrection power that's in this place here today. To lift you up, turn your life around, give you a hope and a future so you can finish strong and be the champions that God's called you to be. Amen. So you can be the champions that God's called you to be. God's not intimidated with your sins here tonight. He died for every one of your sins. The great King David, the Bible says that it was a man after God's own heart. Full-time ministry, serving God, anointed, ridiculously anointed for God, commits adultery, then takes out and puts a contract kill on Bathsheba's husband, Uriah. This is an anointed man of God that the Bible says was a man after God's own heart. Murderer, adulterer. But the Bible says in Psalms 51 that he had an opportunity to go up for the rebound and to shoot again. And the Bible says that he repented. He said, I've sinned and I've sinned against you, O God. Cleanse my heart and renew a right spirit within me. Then he went on and help me so I can go forth, so I can help others and teach them the way and I can tell them that through what I've been through now to help them that they don't have to go through there. Or for some of you in here, because of your past, you're thinking, man, how can God ever? Yeah, you see, your past, see, God works everything together for his glory, the Bible says. All things work together for the good. All things work together for the good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Romans 8:28, all means all. The original Greek, all, means all. Hebrew, all means all. I'm just trying to cover all you for the theologians in this place, amen. All things work, the good, the bad, and the ugly. All things work together for the good. The good, the bad, and the ugly. God will take it all for those who love God. But the key is for those who love God, relationship. So if you're connected to him, and every one of us has the opportunity here tonight to be connected to him, and you're following him, and you're walking with him, God says, I'll take all that, and I'll use it. See, somebody, your story, your testimony, the things you've been through, where the enemy has tried to steal your future, your destiny, your purpose, God's plan for your life, he keeps on reminding you, look at what you've done. Look how bad you've been. God can never use anybody like you. But I'm here to tell you, just like God used David and God used all these in the Bible, you're going to have an opportunity to be sharing to somebody in the future your testimony. What you've been through will become part of your message for somebody out there that's hopeless, for somebody that's out there that's ready to give up, somebody out there that's ready to take their lives. And you'll be over there talking to them, and they'll turn around telling you, you don't understand what I'm going through. You've never been through what I've been through. And then you turn around and say, you don't understand. I've been where you've been. But the thing is, you don't recognize that because I'm not that same person anymore. Because when I said yes to Jesus, when I had an encounter with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, He washed me, He cleansed me, He delivered me, He turned my life around, He gave me a hope, and He gave me a future. And if God did that for me, He'll do it for you. David went on, had another son because he lost his son because of some of the things he went through. But he had another son by name of Solomon, built the temple. And in other words, Solomon, God showed, is symbolic of restoration. When he birthed another son there. That's the God we serve. And in this place here tonight, all had some fun here tonight, but the bottom line is all that we did in the beginning was to bring us to this place. Don't give up. There's an answer to your family. There's an answer to your addiction. There's an answer to that sin. There's an answer to whatever it might be right now that you're going through. But your miracle, your turnaround, starts with the relationship with Him. A surrender to Him. A surrender saying, I can't do this anymore. I need you. Help me. A powerful prayer, I always say, is this. Watch this. You know, we get all religious and theological, physiological, and all that other stuff. Here's a great prayer.
Jesus, help me.
Prayed that a long time ago, and guess what? Still praying it today. You know, you just get to a point where it's like you don't even know how to say it. Take my heart. Can't do this without you. Bible says, apart from Him, we can do nothing, but with Him, we can do all things. There's still time for you to get that rebound and put it back up and be a champion for Jesus. His mercy is here. His grace is here. There's still time to let go of that past. Bible says, when we were yet sinners, Jesus died on the cross for us. What a God, what a Savior. What a God, what a Savior. And there's still time to get back up and to finish strong. Be the man of God that God's called you to be. To be the woman of God that God's called you to be. To be champions for Christ. But are you willing to go up for the rebound? God will take care of the rest. You just have to take the first step. You just have to be willing. As long as you're willing, then God will help you from there. He'll make every one of us dunkers in the spirit. See, some of you thought you can't dunk a basketball, but I'm telling you here, you take the first step and be willing, in the spirit, you'll be dunking all over the place. Amen. So if that's you here tonight, if you've never given your heart to Jesus, tonight's your night. If you've been in the church, you got just bring it down just a little bit. If you've been in the church and you've left, if you've left, and you're thinking, man, it's over. I knew better. I knew the truth. Well, there's a story about the prodigal son that was in the father's house, left the father's house. Spent all his money on wild living, spent it all his inheritance. Then the Bible says he came to his senses, turned around, went back to the father's house. In other words, went back to church. And you know what the father did when he saw his son from a far distance off? You would think the father or would sit there and wait for him to show up and say, I told you so, I told you so. You can come in, but I told you so. You know what the Bible said? That when the father saw his son coming towards him, he ran to his son. He didn't wait for his son to come to him. He ran to the son. Oh, you're not in this. Look, do you understand what's happening here tonight? God's grace, God's love, God's mercy is stretching out to you. And if you're willing, because he'll never force himself on anybody to take that first step, God will run to you and take care of the rest. Amen. He's waiting on you. He's waiting for you. He loves you. So for my prodigals in this room, there's still time to do something great. Not just, I'm not talking about just, I'm talking about doing something great on this earth. Something great for God, because you've all been called to greatness. All the great ones in history became great, not because they didn't fail, it's how they responded to their failure. Michael Jordan got cut, talking about basketball, in high school. The greatest basketball player ever got cut. But because he didn't quit, kept on working on it, thank God for the Chicago fans. Do you hear what I'm saying? In other words, everyone that we consider great, or we look at people as accomplishing greatness, if you go into their history, there was failure. It's just how they responded to their failure. Learn from it, grow from it, and move forward. If that's you right now, in the name of Jesus, never given your heart to the Lord, or you've been away, God is not intimidated with your sins. He died for every one of your sins. The Bible says those who call upon his name shall be saved. Tonight you can make sure that you've been forgiven of your sins, a new start, a clean slate, and to move forward, to leave this place with Jesus in your heart, with your passport to heaven, and in the power of God to help you accomplish his purpose in your life on this earth. For God says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Apart from him, you can do nothing. With him, you can do all things, okay? Tonight's your night. Don't play Russian roulette with your eternity tonight. Tomorrow's not guaranteed to nobody. Death is not the end. It's only the beginning. And death is going to come knocking at everyone's door sooner or later. But it's not the end. It's only the beginning. I'm going to say it like this. Do you know that you know that if death came knocking at you, do you know that you'd be going to heaven tonight? Do you know you're living right for God? That your heart is where it needs to be? If not, please tonight, go up for the rebound and respond to this altar call. And I promise you, I'm not saying it's going to be easy, that you're not going to go through some stuff, but I'm going to tell you it's going to be worth it, and God's going to help you. And God, if we can all stand to our feet, no one leaving this room unless it's an emergency during this altar call. Absolutely nobody moving unless it's an emergency during this altar call. This is a holy moment. This is why Jesus came to this earth. This is why we have church. If that's you in this place, you say, Pastor, that's me. I want to get right with God. I'm tired of being tired. I've missed many shots. If that's you, on the count of three, if I could see your hand, just go up. If you've been away from God, or you've never given your heart to Jesus, Hold on one second. If that's you, on the count of three, just lift up your hand. One, two, three, just lift up your hands. All over. Yes. Keep them living. Okay. Amen. What I want to do right now is this. Every hand that went up and no one leaving yet, please. Every hand that went up, this is your step of faith. This is you telling God, here I am. I'm tired of doing it my way. I don't want to keep on. I want to live for you. I want to fulfill my purpose for your glory. I want to make sure I'm going to heaven. Here I am. The first step. Then God will do the rest. He's the miracle worker. You do the possible. He'll do the impossible. Your turnaround starts with that step of faith. So every hand that went up, I want you to step out of your seat and make your way up to this altar so I can pray for you. Quickly. Every hand, quickly. Don't worry about everybody else around you. Just step out of your seat, make your way up. And just find a place right here. Quickly. Every hand that went up. Yeah, just help them. You know, you can get it. Come on, church. This is awesome. Look at this. They're coming, all over. Help him up, help him up.
Guys, I can be with you.
No one leaving unless it's an emergency. Hallelujah. Glorious. We're waiting. There's still a few more people that need to be up here. Come on. Don't miss your miracle. Don't miss your turnaround. Come on. Tonight's your night. God's grace is here tonight. God's mercy is here tonight. To rebound, to get back up, to move forward and be the champion that God's called you to be. Still coming. Right here, right here. Bring him up here. Bring this one.
Take me to that place, to that sacred place.
Still coming. Hallelujah. Watch this, watch this. Before we pray, we're about to pray. Again, rebound, to increase or improve after a recent decrease or decline. You're about to improve. You're about to increase. And you know why? Because of the one that brings the increase. When you get connected to God, there is no negative or backwards with God. You will never see in the Bible anything negative or backwards connected to Him. It's forward. It's resurrection power. So when He comes into your life, resurrection power comes into your life. Resurrection power can't go backwards. Resurrection power can't even go sideways. It only knows one thing. In other words, eventually, you might go through some stuff, but eventually, as you stay with them and trust them, you're coming through and you're coming out and you're going up. There's increase coming your way. There's improvement coming your way. So no matter what the decline might have been and why and what caused it, tonight, things are going to change. There's a turnaround about to take place in your life. I said there's a turnaround that's about to take place in your life. I want you to look at the person next to you in the crowd. Just for a few more minutes before we, I don't want to miss nobody. And ask them, do you need to be at this altar call? Do you need somebody to walk with you? And just make sure that we don't miss anybody. Just to sing a couple more verses one more time and then we're going to pray. Come on now. Hallelujah. Ask your neighbor. And if it's, I'll walk with you. I'll come with you. Come on now. Hallelujah. One more verse. Yes. Yes. Thank you. They're still coming. Hallelujah. Still coming. Bring them up this way, the front.
There is a God who loves me.
Hallelujah. Right here. They're still coming. Come on.
Yeah.
getting back up. Come on now. Come on now. Come on now. Run to Jesus. Run to Jesus. Watching online right now, your altar is right where you're at. Man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. God's seeing your heart right now. Right where you're at, watching online, that is your altar. Amen. Guys, the Bible is very clear. This is Bible. When we call upon His name, He's faithful to forgive us as far as the east is from the west. In other words, to wash us and cleanse us of all our sins and give us a new start. And He remembers it no more. I want you to think about that. He remembers it no more. We have a tendency to remind people and ourselves and what we, and God says, I don't remember it after you came to me. So after tonight, let go of that. God's about to start a new chapter in your life, your greatest chapter. But I want to say something. Starting tonight, though, after this prayer, God's faithful, the greatest miracles of all is salvation. Yes. God is faithful for the ones that have walked away from church that knew better. God's here. A righteous man falls up. I said that already. He gets back up. Get back up and get back in. But very important to get in church, though. God, the miracle, it starts with Him. But then we still have to put action to our faith. We have to do the possible. Follow the manual. It's like trying to put a bike together. I don't know about you. If I try to put a bike without reading the manual, I guess even when I read the manual, anyway, praise God. But you understand what I'm saying? You understand what I'm saying? The manual is the Bible. So God says, go to church, read the Bible, pray. So I want to encourage you after tonight, get in church. Again, we'd love to have you here. I know some are part of this church. It's just been away for a while. But for the ones that this is your first time here, you need to get in church and get around and get involved and get around. Get it. Because faith, the Bible says, comes by hearing the word of God. See, tonight faith has risen in your life. You heard something and you responded. So tonight, I want to encourage you after tonight to get in church. If you're coming from a long distance away, we'll help you find a church if you can't make it here. I want to encourage you, for some here tonight, make sure you're back here tomorrow. Get up early in the morning and get back to church. All right? Get back to church. There's information in the bookstore about all the things that happened during the week. We got Bible studies for the men, for the women, children things, for the children, okay? So you got to be, that's your part afterwards, okay? So watch it online. I want us all to pray this prayer together. The word's very clear when we call upon His name. Are you ready? Let's pray this prayer together. Heavenly Father, come to You tonight. I need You. I'm a sinner. I've missed many shots. and I need a Savior. And I believe, Heavenly Father, that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, on this earth to die for me, for my sins. And I receive your Son, Jesus, into my heart as Lord and Savior of my life. Not my will, but your will to be done after tonight. Wash me with your blood, Jesus. Forgive me of my sins and renew a right spirit within me. From this night forth, I'm all yours. I believe that those who call upon your name, Jesus, shall be saved. So tonight, I believe, because your word says it, I believed it, confessed it, that settles it, that I am saved, I'm on my way to heaven, my sins have been forgiven, and my greatest days are ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the Lord. Lift up your hands. Lift up your hands right now. Just lift up your hands. Lord, I just pray right now for your people right now. Fill them. Fill them. Fill them. Upper room, Pentecost, chapter 2, Lord. Fill them with fire. Fill them with power. Fill them with passion, with hunger for your word, to seek your face, to be witnesses for your glory, and never look back in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray breakthrough right now. Chains to break. Addictions to break. Cycles to break. I pray restoration right now in people's lives, family. I pray right now the crooked places to be made straight, Lord God. I pray crazy favor to invade their homes and their future, opportunities to go forward and doors to open up. For your glory, I pray that right now in the name of Jesus. Your anointing right now. Your anointing right now to remove every burden, destroy every yoke in this house and watching at home. I pray restoration. I pray physical healing, spiritual healing, past hurts, hurts in the heart. Lord, I pray right now that you touch hearts, restore, heal. In the name of Jesus, fill them, bless them, in Jesus' name. Somebody shout, I receive it. Woo! Hallelujah. God bless every one of you. We're dismissed. We'll see you tomorrow. Amen. All my prayer warriors, everyone that can pray, let's pray. Let's pray.